Tonight to have Father Emmanuel with us, member of the Franciscan Order based in New York, the Franciscan Friars of the Renewal. I was part of this community for 3 years, and my first year I lived with Father Emmanuel. He's not the reason I left. He did his best to try and chase me, but I had fortitude and stayed for a while. Great blessing to have him here tonight. It's been a while since I've heard him preach, so I'm looking forward to that. He has some good homilies in the friary. Thanks, it's a blessing to have you with us, and looking forward to a great night. Thanks, Father.
Great. Thank you, Grant. Well, thank you all for coming. It's wonderful to be with you. As Grant said, I'm Father Emmanuel. I'm a member of a new Franciscan community called the Franciscan Friars of the Renewal. So we were founded in New York City 36 years ago. And our main work is living with and serving the materially poor and then preaching the gospel. So that's why we're here tonight, to share with you the good news of sharing the good news. I've been in touch with Nate a little bit, and he was saying that doing a series on mission, which is awesome. And I realized that the Archbishop's pastoral sort of document is called You Will Be My Witnesses. And so we're going to talking this evening about what does it mean to be a witness in our culture today to the good news of the gospel. Just to tell you a little bit about myself before we pray. So I was born in England. You may hear a little bit of an accent. My first stop when I came from England was St. Paul, Minnesota. So it was in the 90s. And I had been accepted as a missionary with Net Ministries, so 1995. And I'm like, where is Minnesota? So you have to try, especially the young ones, have to try and imagine a world without the internet. So my parents had a globe. It's a round thing with like a map all over it. And so they had a globe, and I looked on the globe, and there's America. I see, oh, it's in the north by Canada. It will be freezing there. I came in July. It was 100 degrees when we landed. And I walked out there. Oh, I'm from England. If you've been to England, the climate is moderate. So I wasn't prepared for the humidity of Minnesota. But I had a blessed time. I served with NET from 1995 to 1996 as a missionary traveling around the U.S. doing retreats for high schoolers. And then I worked for them for 2 years, so 1996 to 1998, and lived in West St. Paul. Lived on Grand Avenue for 1 year in an SPO house, and then lived in West St. Paul. So it's always like coming back to the Twin Cities. So it's a blessing. It's a blessing to see Grant again. As he said, we've known each other for a few years. So yeah, just wonderful to be with you. I've been a friar, joined in 1998, so after my 3 years in Minnesota, I joined the Friars in 1998, was ordained a priest in 2007, and then sent back to England to kind of evangelize my own people. So I was there for 7 years, from 2007 to 2014, and then became the vocation director for the Friars. So I came back here in 2014, and here we are. So, and I'm here this weekend. There's another event going on at the Net Center for young people. So kind of a combination of the thing they hear this evening and then something tomorrow. So if you can pray, there's going to be 500 teenagers. It's called the Archdiocese and Youth Day. So if you can pray for that, I'd be really grateful. Okay, let's pray. In the name of the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Father, for your love for us. Thank you, Father, for gathering us here this evening as your children, as the church. Thank you, Father, for sending us Jesus, your Son, who has come to seek and save that which was lost. Lord Jesus, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us this evening. That you would fan into a flame the gift of the Holy Spirit that we received at baptism and confirmation. That we would desire to share the love that we have received with those you send us to. Lord, we ask that you would open our hearts tonight to hear your word, to be encouraged, to be strengthened, to be challenged. And Mother Mary, please pray for us and with us as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. So I love the Easter season. You know, so we had 40 days of Lent, we now have 50 days of Easter. And throughout the Easter season, we go through the Acts of the Apostles. And the Acts of the Apostles is really where you see the power of the Holy Spirit at work in the early church's life. Sometimes the Acts of the Apostles is called the Gospel of the Holy Spirit, which I think is beautiful. And because what you see is the disciples of Jesus are now living the life of Jesus. So what Jesus did and said, they are now doing and saying. And you're saying the same things. People are experiencing his love, experiencing healing, experiencing new life. And so you see the body of Christ kind of lived in the midst of the world. And that's something beautiful, because that's really us as a church, is to live the life of Jesus in the midst of the world. And so that's what we're going to be speaking about tonight. I'm going to tell you a number of stories. I think stories help just to communicate a message. So the first one is, we tend to live and work with, as I said, the materially poor. So I live in Paterson, New Jersey right now, which is about 30-minute drive from New York City. I've lived there for the past almost 2 years. And it's a pretty tough neighborhood. There's gangs there, it's violent, there's a lot of drugs, but there's a lot of beautiful people. And so in the summer, last summer, what I would like to do sometimes in the evenings, I would walk around the neighborhood just praying my rosary. And especially if you live in the inner city and it's hot inside, it's nice to get out. And so a lot of people in the evenings are out because it's a little bit cooler on the block, just kind of hanging out. And so I'd walk down our street, it's called Butler Street, and then turn right, and then walk back up the other street called Highland. And that was my little rosary circle. So I'm doing this walk, and then people stop you and talk, and then I just kind of pause my rosary and then just kind of carry on. And I get to the end of Butler, I take a right, I turn up Highland, and because I was fairly new to the neighborhood last summer, I didn't know that at the end of Highland, at the bottom there, there's a lot of families that live there with children. So it's the evening, it's still light, the children are all playing. You know, they're playing tag, they're playing jump rope, they're just playing. And then I'm just walking, and then they see me, and they're like, whoa. And so these kids, probably eight children, maybe 10 children, just run. They're all, you know, sort of maybe between 6 and 11 years old. And they all just run, and then you stand there. And they just look at me, and then one of them says, "Are you God?" And so I said, "No, I said, I just work for him." He works for him. He works for him. And then this little boy says, he's obviously watched some of the superhero movies. He's like, "Can you teleport?" Teleport where you just kind of go from one spot to the other without like moving, right? And I'm like, no. And then by this point, you can see they're like, this kid goes, "Do you have any special powers?" Now I'm a priest, right? So I do, but I didn't feel like they could necessarily understand the theological. So, you know, we talked for a little bit, and then I said, "Can I pray for you guys?" And they're like, "Shh, he's going to pray for us." And it was beautiful, right? So I just prayed for them. And then just as I was leaving, this little girl, and very interesting, right? Her name is Vision. So my sleeves were rolled up because it was hot. And so she just got her hand and she just went like this. She put her hand on my arm. What was she doing? She was seeing if I was real. She wanted to see if I was real. Almost like in the gospel, right? The Apostle Thomas. I'm not going to believe unless I put my hand in his side and in the hands of where the nails were. I tell you that story, brothers and sisters, because when they saw me and they saw the way I looked, they said, okay, first of all, he represents God. They knew that. Then the second thing they wanted to know, is there something different about you, right? Can you teleport? Do you have any special powers? What are they asking? Do you have anything supernatural about you? Because if you're connected with God, the connection is therefore there must be something supernatural about you. And then the last thing, are you real? Are you real? And what I want to say to us is, brothers and sisters, as believers, as followers of Jesus, the world says the same things. Once you're identified as a Catholic and someone who takes their faith or is seeking to take their faith seriously, they want to know, is there something different about you? Right? Is there something different about you? Do you have any special powers? Right? And are you real? Are you real? What does that mean? It means, are you authentic? Like, does what you say with your lips match up with how you live? Because this is what the world wants to know. Is this real? This message, this Christian message, is it real? I flew from Newark, New Jersey this morning. And I'm very interested to see what happens in the culture and how it sort of reflects people's longing for God. So this was on the back of a young woman. This was on her hoodie. She had a black hooded sweatshirt. And I was struck by it. So I didn't want to get weirded out, but I was standing there. And I was writing down what was on the back of her hoodie. Thankfully, it was Newark Airport. And there's a lot of people. I think people are like, what's that guy got a little... I mean, who carries a pad these days, right? Yeah. Only friars. Yeah, they're like, is he a police officer? So this is it. It's kind of intense. This is on the back of her hoodie. Take your life. Disappear into the night. I ain't saying it's right, but it comes with this life. What struck me was, one, where is that from? Is it from a song? Is it a poem that she wrote? Then why is she wearing it the day that she chooses to travel? Obviously, there's some kind of suffering in her life. But she's communicating without necessarily communicating. And I think, brothers and sisters, the culture that we live in is really suffering and doesn't necessarily know where the answer is. They know there's a lot of suffering. They know there's darkness. But where is the answer? So I want to tell you another story. This was me coming back actually from a flight in Vancouver. Actually, I was flying here to do something with Net in St. Paul. So I'm sitting, thankfully, I was seated in the exit row, so that was nice. And I'm in the aisle, and then there's another guy by the window, and then the seat between us was open, and he gets on, and he's in his mid-20s, and he had a couple of piercings, right? Maybe one, I think, is an eyebrow, one in his nose, and maybe one around his lip or somewhere, maybe earring, I can't remember. But I just remember thinking, oh, interesting guy, you know? And we can all make judgments, right? We look at people and we make judgments, and I'm sure I did. So then I very innocently just asked him, and I was being really sincere. I said, excuse me, do you know how long the flight is? Like, I didn't know how far west we were. I didn't exactly know where is Minnesota from Vancouver. He said, yeah, it's about 2 hours. Like, oh, that's great. It's not as long as I thought. So then now he's interested, right? So he looks at me and he says, oh, can I ask you, what are you? Right? which is fine, right? It's a fine question. So I said, oh, I'm a Franciscan. You know, I'm kind of like a monk, and we live in, I think I was living in New York City at the time, and he's like, oh, okay. And I asked him what he was doing, and he ran a bike store in Vancouver, and he was going to visit in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, the guy that founded this chain of bike stores, so that he could learn from him. So like, so we talked a little bit about that, and then it goes quiet. And he said, can I ask you a question? I said, sure. He said, what's the difference between celibacy and chastity? I was not expecting that question from this young man. What's the difference between celibacy and chastity? So I said, well, I said, if I understand it correctly, celibacy is abstaining from sexual activity, and chastity is sort of more your interior, how you relate to other people. You know, so it's not just your activity externally, it's also how you think about others, how you relate to others, even how you carry yourself. It's to do with your sexuality. He said, oh, yeah. He said, I thought there was something like that. He said, I've been celibate for the past 3 years. And I wasn't expecting that either. Now I'm really intrigued. So I turned and I look at him and I said, can you tell me about that? And he said, yeah. He said, I grew up in this culture in Canada. He said, very sexualized culture. And he said, I was very sexually active. He said, and then at a certain point, I realized I'm hurting myself. He said, and then I realized I'm hurting others. He said, so I decided I don't want to do this anymore. I said, wow, that's incredible. And then so we talked about it. I tell you those two stories, brothers and sisters, because I think they highlight sort of the culture, right? So there's a lot of darkness and there's a lot of suffering, the woman with the hoodie, and there's also a lot of good. And there's young people, even just listening to their hearts, that are coming to the sense of, like, there must be more than this. There must be more than this. This is this young man just listening to his own experiences. I don't want to be sexually active anymore. No, and I said to him, did anyone teach you that stuff? Were you raised in a religious home? He said, no, I was raised with no faith. So then we have a conversation. He said, you know, he said, I like to learn from experts. He said, that's why I'm going to go and see this guy who's running the bike store. He said, I want to learn from him. How did he do it? He said, so I figure you're an expert in God. Maybe you can tell me about God. Beautiful. So we started talking about Jesus. But it says there's a hunger in our culture for meaning, for truth, for authentic love. And where does the answer come? From Jesus. But where is Jesus' body? Here. Right here. And so really, that's what we're going to be just talking about for the next 20 minutes or so. Pope John Paul II said this: the new evangelization that can make the 21st century a springtime of the gospel is a task for the entire people of God, but will depend in a decisive way on the lay faithful, that's all of you, so non-priests, non-deacons, Father Justice is a priest, so. On the lay faithful being fully aware of their baptismal vocation and their responsibility for bringing the good news of Jesus to their culture and their society. So basically, what is he saying? He's saying that basically the fact of the church evangelizing the world depends in a decisive way on lay people. On lay people. Because why? Because the priests tend to be in the parish. And the priest's job is to preach the gospel to the people in the pews. And the role of the people in the pews is to then share the gospel with the people in their families, in their places of work, amongst their friends, And that's how the world is changed. It depends, first of all, on us knowing, like, okay, people actually want to know. Right? That's why I told you those stories. Like, people really do want to know. I'm one of three. There's three of us. Me, I have a sister who's 2 years younger than me, and then a brother who's a year younger than her. And they all still live in England. And in 2016, my sister got married. And I was very blessed to do her wedding. And so that was August of 2016. So then later that year, 2016, November, I was home visiting the Friars, but I got to spend a couple of days with my family. And so we all went for a walk. There's a bunch of us. My brother has four kids. And so we're all out for a walk. And then me and my brother were at the back of the group. And then my sister just dropped back and she said, "Guys, I've got some news for you." And she said, "I'm pregnant." And it was beautiful because she got married when she was 41. So it was beautiful. You know, the fact that they conceived pretty quickly. And then she said, "But don't tell anyone." She said, "Because only 2 months. And we're going to wait till the 3 months mark," which I understand is pretty common, "to tell someone." So I said, "Fiona," I looked at her and I said, "I'm a priest." I said, "That's what I do. I don't tell people stuff." Right? That's part of the job. And she looks at me and, you know, so then, you know, finish up my time at home, go back to the friary, and I'm at dinner with the brothers and they're like, "Hey, how's your time at home?" And I was like, "Oh, it's great." "Oh, how's your family doing?" They're like, "Yeah, they're good, thanks." They're like, "Oh, how's your sister? She just got married, right?" I was like, "Yeah, she's pregnant." I was like, "Oh, I wasn't supposed to say anything." But see, the interesting thing is that you can't keep good news inside. Right? That's normal. When we have good news to share, it comes out. Like, my sister actually had to tell us, "Please don't say anything." And even then, I just kind of blurted it out. And so my first question for you, brothers and sisters, is your faith good news? Is your faith good news? Because I want to propose this to you. If it's good news for you, then it's good news for everyone. It's not just this subjective, "Oh, it's nice for me." If your experience of God has changed your life, if it's real and meaningful and you experience peace, then guess what? Others can experience the same thing. You see, I also think that the culture, almost like my sister, tells us in subtle ways, "Don't tell anyone." Yep, you found good news, but don't say anything. Don't be a fanatic. You know? And we're going to talk about how to do it and how not to do it, all that kind of stuff in a minute. But please just don't impose it on me. And then what happens is the church can tend to be what I call a holy huddle. Right? Where this is good. We love this. And we get together and we have a social and we hang out and we pray. But then when people say to me, you know, maybe you go back to your roommate or you go back to work the next day and someone says, "Oh, what did you do last night?" "Oh, just hung out with a few friends." "Well, where did you hang out with a few friends?" "You know, Northeast." "At church. You were at church." But we're so terrified they're going to think I'm weird. Well, guess what? You are weird. And I'm really weird. Look. And you know what? People actually find it attractive in our day and age because no one knows what life is about anymore. We're just kind of like groping in the dark for answers. And so when someone actually proposes something with a certain confidence, and we're going to talk about the need for the Holy Spirit in a moment, then that's attractive. It's attractive. So I would just say to you that your community here, especially the young adults here, I've heard that you have a good little community which is growing, which is awesome, that it cannot be this holy huddle, right, where we just kind of get together and it's just for us. If you look at the apostles after the resurrection, that was kind of the apostles. That was the holy huddle, right? They're in the upper room, they're afraid, but they're together, and that was good. But then what happens? The morning of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes down, and they're all filled with the Holy Spirit, who is who? The love of God. And they go out. St. Peter, who maybe a few weeks before had denied Jesus to a servant girl, this big kind of burly fisherman, when he was asked by a little servant girl, "Aren't you one of his disciples?" "Not me." Suddenly he's transformed and he goes out into the square and he preaches. He tells them that they crucified Jesus. And 3,000 people are baptized. Brothers and sisters, this is why we need the Holy Spirit. Acts. And this is the Archbishop's document, right? He says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And then you will be my witnesses, not only in Jerusalem, but throughout Judea and Samaria, and indeed to the ends of the earth." And the amazing thing, as I said at the beginning of the talk, is then throughout Acts of the Apostles, you see that happen. You see these men and women who were fearful and timid transformed. So much so that the people thought they were drunk. Right? You know, Pentecost morning. What do they say? They say, "Oh, they've been drinking too much new wine." What do people do when they're drunk? They do crazy things, right? If you've ever had a bit too much to drink, you'll be like, "Ah!" And your friends are like, "Shut up, sit down." Because what does alcohol do? It lowers our inhibitions. And then so we do things that we wouldn't normally do when we've had too much to drink. Sometimes we tell people things that we wish we'd tell them normally. Right? And you realize, "Oh, I probably shouldn't have said that last night." But these men and women at Pentecost, they're not drunk under alcohol. Alcohol lowers our reason, right? So we act less than reasonably. We do things that we wouldn't normally do if we were thinking reasonably. The Holy Spirit actually helps us to act above our reason. So we're not so timid or like worried about what others think. But we do it in a supernatural way rather than a less than reasonable way. It goes beyond our reason rather than beneath our reason. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and then you will be my witnesses, right? That's why we struggle, I think, sometimes to witness to our faith, because we need the Holy Spirit. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and then you will be my witnesses, not only in Jerusalem, but throughout Judea and Samaria, and indeed to the ends of the earth. There's a wonderful document written by Pope Paul VI called Evangelii Nuntiandi, The Good News in the Modern World. It was written in 1975. Right now, Pope Francis, he gives these Wednesday addresses, and he's speaking about this document. He says it's as relevant, even though it's written, whatever that is, close to 50 years ago, he says still very, very relevant today. And one of the things that Pope Paul VI says this, he says, "The Holy Spirit is the primary agent of evangelization." The Holy Spirit is the primary agent of evangelization. I love that because it takes the pressure off a little bit. Right? We were talking just at dinner. I had dinner at Megan and Nate's house with Grant and Matt. And Matt was saying that he had this awesome conversation. Was it a bachelor party? A bachelor party in a bar. And he happened to have either like a rosary around his neck or a cross or something. And this young woman just approaches him. They start talking. And she bursts into tears while she's talking with him. My grandma, when I was young, told me, pray the rosary. Always pray the rosary. She said, and then she starts sharing with him her heart. I'm in this relationship with this man. I don't know where it's going. And Matt's like, I don't even know how I got here. Like, I don't even know what I'm supposed to say. It's the Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters. See, the Holy Spirit is already at work in your colleagues' lives. And we just kind of have to get in the stream. Like, what the Holy Spirit is doing is just to be that person to kind of help them take the next step. So imagine this young woman goes home. She's like, whoa, what just happened? Maybe she had a bit to drink, right? But she talked to someone about her faith, something that was a deep inside of her question. Where else did she go with those questions? Where else did she go with her struggle about this relationship that she's in with this man? A guy she met in a bar who happens to be wearing a cross, who's just allowing the Lord to use him as best he can. This is beautiful. The Holy Spirit is the primary agent of evangelization. But we have to desire to be used, right? We have to kind of be open, like Matt was, to being used by God. It's a nice tune. It's okay. So I'm going to just tell one more story, and then we're going to give some little practicals, and then we can have maybe a little time for question and answers if you guys have any questions or answers. So I was flying back, I think, from Atlanta, and I just said to the Lord, and occasionally I'll say this, Lord, yeah, if you could just open the door just so I can share the gospel with someone. Right? So I prayed for it. So I fly all the way from Atlanta back to New York City. Then I get the bus back into Harlem where I was living. Didn't talk to anyone really. No significant conversation. Then I'm walking back up the street towards our friary. And in New York City, because when COVID happened, they built like a lot of, they probably did around the Twin Cities as well, like little outdoor seating so that people could sit outside, you know, and feel a little bit safer and rather than go inside. So there's these three guys sitting outside, big, young African-American men. And so I walk past them, and I got my bags on my shoulders. I'm walking home. And then one of the guys looks at me, and I just kind of catch his eye. He looks at mine. He just goes like this. So I walk over, and first thing he says to me, he goes, you voted for 45, didn't you? And I'm like, what? He goes, you voted for 45. And I'm like, who's 45? He goes, Trump. Trump was still the president at the time. And I'm like, no, I didn't. I said, I'm from England. I can't vote here. So then he says to me, well, you would have voted for 45, wouldn't you? So then we start talking, right? And the three of them share with me about how in the last year or two, since Trump had become president, they had experienced more racism than they had growing up in America. So what did I do? I listened. I'll be honest. When he first said to me, you voted for 45, I was frustrated. I'm like, you've seen a white guy walking through the neighborhood. You've judged me. But then I realized I just need to listen. So then, you know, we talk. And I said, brothers, I said, I'm with you guys. I said, I live in the neighborhood. I live in the neighborhood. They're like, where do you live? I said, I live just down here on 142. They're like, oh, he said 142. He said 142. Now, what I realized was, generally speaking, white people would refer it as 142nd. Black people tend to call it 142. Now, I lived in the neighborhood for 5 years at that point. Maybe sometimes I call it 142nd Street. Maybe other times I call it 142. But the Holy Spirit is leading the conversation. So because he's leading the conversation, I say 142, and that connects with these young men. Because they feel like, oh, you get us. You're with us. And brothers and sisters, that's part of it. You see, I can't necessarily evangelize your colleagues or your friends because they'll think I'm too much. Right? Like, yo, Grant, your friend the monk, I'm sure he's a nice guy, but that's a bit much for me. But you guys, right? They know you. You work with them. You hang out with them. See them at family events. And to recognize that the Holy Spirit is at work in the lives of those whom you encounter each day. But am I open to being an instrument? So it's beautiful. So I carry on talking with these young men, and one of them says, oh, I'm Catholic. I said, oh. I said, did you know that there's actually an African-American Catholic church just down on 138th Street, St. Charles Borromeo? And I said, why don't you go there? And he goes, I'm not ready to submit. So we went, right? Look at that conversation. We went from like, you voted for 45, to now me encouraging him to go to church and him saying, I'm not ready to submit. Very honest. So then I prayed with them. There we are on the street, and I prayed for my three brothers. And this is, I tell you those stories because the Holy Spirit is at work in the midst of the world. Right? And I want to encourage you and to challenge you, like, just not to stay kind of comfortable. Like, I prayed that morning, right? Lord, give me an opportunity to share you with someone. And it wasn't until I was like three blocks from home. But he was faithful. He was faithful. This is St. Paul, the letter to the Ephesians. He says, Ephesians 6, verse 19. Pray for me to be given an opportunity to open my mouth and speak without fear and give out the mystery of the gospel, of which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that in proclaiming it, I may speak as boldly as I ought to. As I ought to. So sometimes we don't want to be too much, but we don't want to be too little. Pray. He says, pray that I may be given an opportunity. Part of it, brothers and sisters, is desiring, right, to be used by the Lord, and then praying for that grace. And then trust, you know, as Matt did. All right, Lord. And I'll be honest, I've made mistakes. Because we're human. And sometimes when I've wimped out of saying something in a conversation, because I worried too much what the person would say to me or think of me. You know? But we learn. And we grow. But it's exciting. So I'm just going to close with three sort of proposals to you of how to witness. You will receive power, Acts 1:8, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and then you will be my witnesses. So my witnesses. So first of all, I have to be in relationship with Jesus, right? To be a witness to him, I have to be in relationship with him. It has to mean something for me. My faith has to be good news for me. Otherwise, I won't want to share it. So this is the first thing. You, and then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So then how do I witness? One, I witness to the charity or to the love of God. It's beautiful today. I'm sitting on the plane. You know, I'm in the aisle, and the flight attendant started coming by. The guy next to me, he pulls out a little pack of cashew nuts that he had in his bag. And then, you know what? He pulled out another bag. He goes, "Do you want one?" He gave me a bag of cashew nuts. I was hungry. You know? He witnessed to charity. Then it opened the door. We had a nice conversation. Right? Simple things spark things in people. Right? Well, remember I told you the story about the kids? People are looking, are you different because you're a believer? I made a decision some years ago that I would try, and it's good, I've forgotten it, so I need to do it again, but I would try when I'm going through the city to bring like granola bars with me or something, some kind of food, so that if I meet a homeless person, I can give them some food. So I was going through Brooklyn, going to visit a friend, and I see this man on the street, and I just talk to him, and I give him a granola bar, and then I carry on. And I was with two other brothers, and then I hear this guy behind me, "Excuse me!" And I turn around, the young man, he says, "Are you a monk?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm strictly speaking, I'm a friar, right? But it's not the time to get into theological subtleties, right? You just say yes. I can tell him later if he's interested." He says, "Are you a monk?" And I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Where do you monk at?" Now, monk isn't a verb, right? But it's okay. So then he says to me, he says, "Anyone that does good in the community, I'm interested in." He saw that little act of generosity, and it sparked in him, like, "Who are you?" He tells me he's Jewish. I give him a miraculous medal. I tell him to look up Alphonse Ratisbonne, who's converted, Jewish man, by the miraculous medal. Right? Little things. It was a three-minute conversation as we're walking. It began because I gave a granola bar to a homeless person. See, the world is looking for credibility from us, right? Are you who you say you are? Witness to charity, that's the first one. The other one, witness to holiness. So, okay, you're like, "Yeah, Father, the reason why you have all these cool stories is because you wear a habit. And I don't wear a habit." There's some truth to that. But there's also some things that you don't have to wear different clothes. You don't have to wear different clothes, right? You don't have to wear the clothes of a friar or a priest, but your life should look different. Because when your life looks different, that's what provokes questions. What provokes questions for me is I look different. But if your life looks different, that also, if people say at work, "Hey, I notice when everyone's talking about Sharon and how bad she is, you never say anything. I noticed that." Or, "You don't cuss much." Right? Huh. In our day and age, that's interesting. It's simple things that now are becoming, this was how the early church evangelized. Their life was attractive because it was different. Witness to holiness. We've got Batman's helicopter. It's awesome. So there's some young men that hang out in our neighborhood, you know, just like on the street. And I see them sometimes when I go on my rosary walk. And I've had some great conversations with them. And I think it was last Friday, we were walking around and I said, "Hey, Jonas." The other guy's name, his street name is Wise. I said, "Hey, Wise." And then Jonas looks at his other friend who I hadn't met. He goes, "These guys, they'll remember your name, man." Isn't that interesting? He's moved just by the fact that I remember his name. Because maybe no one remembers his name. Maybe he doesn't feel important. Maybe that's why he's on the street doing whatever he's doing, because he wants to feel important. Little things, brothers and sisters, speak to people. So witness to charity, witness to holiness. And then the last one, the word witness comes from the Greek, martyr. Martyr. It's going to cost you something. right? The first 30 popes, the first 30 of 31, so there was one that wasn't, were all martyrs. You know, like when we have Eucharistic prayer one, and you hear the priest say, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, martyrs, martyrs, martyrs. And so if we're living in a time when, you know, we're kind of going back to the early church, you may not be martyred physically, but it does mean that you're kind of going to have to go against the flow, right? You're going to have to stand up a little bit and go against the tide of the culture. Pope John Paul II, I have a little quote from him. This was in Rome in the year 2000 at World Youth Day. He says, "Dear friends, to believe in Jesus today, to follow Jesus as Peter, Thomas, and the first apostles and witness did, demands of us, just as it did in the past, that we take a stand for him, almost to the point of a new martyrdom, the martyrdom of those who today, as yesterday, are called to go against the tide in order to follow the divine master, to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Perhaps you will not have to shed your blood, but you will certainly be asked to be faithful to Christ." My mom is a great example to me of this. My mom's 72 years old. My uncle came to stay with us a few years ago, and he's living with a lady who's not his wife. My mom said, "If you're going to stay, you're very welcome, but you need to stay in different rooms." That was not popular. But it's my mom's house. She's a believer. She doesn't want sin happening under her roof. That caused tension, right? But it also witnessed. There's a certain martyrdom, brothers and sisters, to living out our faith. And we'll close with the scripture and we can see if you have any questions. This is St. Paul to Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 to 7. "That is why I'm reminding you now to fan into a flame the gift that God gave you when I laid my hands on you." Talking about the Holy Spirit. "God's gift is not a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power and love and self-control. So you are never to be ashamed of witnessing to the Lord, but to bear the hardships for the sake of the good news, relying on the power of God." Relying on the power of God. Let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for my brothers and sisters who are here this evening. Thank you for the gift of their faith. Thank you, Lord, that you have revealed yourself to us, and that you give to us a mission, Lord, to bear witness to you in the midst of the world. Holy Spirit, we just ask that you would come upon us now. That you would give us courage. That you would inflame our hearts with love. Lord, that our relationship with you would first of all be good news for me, so that I desire to share it with others. Please fill us, Lord, to overflowing. Please give us courage and confidence. Please help us to trust, Holy Spirit, that you will use us even in our weaknesses, even in our fear, our timidity, that you will use us as instruments of the good news for a world that desires to know you. Mother Mary, please pray for us as you prayed with and for the apostles in the upper room, that we would be docile to all that the Holy Spirit asks of us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. So maybe we'll take a little few minutes for questions, and then we're going to have a couple of songs. Jeremy's going to lead us in a little bit of worship before we finish. Anyone have any thoughts, comments, questions? Yeah.
I'm wondering how, we're kind of talking about this in the Bible here. How do you not, how do you affirm the other person that maybe you're trying to manage without affirming, maybe the lifestyle that you're leading?
Yeah, great question. I think the first thing I would say, it's often, especially with family members, is building relationship. You know, so it's that they know that you love them, that, you know. I'll give you an example from my own life. So my uncle, very sadly, his wife died of cancer. Probably 10 or 15 years ago. So he just met someone else, and he made the decision not to get married in the church. So he invited me to the wedding. I was in New York, so I wrote to him and said I couldn't go. I wrote and said I was very happy. I had met the woman that he's marrying. I wrote and said I was very happy. I know how hard it was for him when my auntie died. And then I just said at the end, I said, if you would ever like to have your marriage blessed in the church, please let me know. I'd love to talk to you about it. So I affirm that I'm sad for him when he lost his wife. I'm happy for him that he's met this woman. I don't say too much about that, but I propose something, a good. So I affirm what I can, and I point to the good in a sensitive way. Does that make sense? Yeah, but I think it's... Again, that's why I said the Holy Spirit is the primary agent of evangelization, because we really, in this day and age, we really need the Holy Spirit, because there's a lot of these tricky conversations, you know, and you might make a mistake here and there, you know, but I think it's okay, you know. Does anyone else have any other thoughts about that? Thoughts of your own experience? Or just feel free, like I'm not saying I'm the expert. I think we're all walking together in this. Okay. But it's a great question. Maybe I'll just give you another. Again, sometimes for me, stories help, like anecdotally, right? So I'm on the plane. This was 2 weeks ago, flying down to Dallas. And I like to sit in the aisle. So I'm always sitting in the aisle, right? It's just more comfortable for me. I can get out easy if I need to. Young woman sitting next to me in the middle seat. And then as we start our descent, she fell asleep during the flight. As we start our descent, I hear, I'm like, she have a cold? No, she was crying. So I just turned to her, I said, are you okay? And she said, well, yeah. She said, I just got some relationship difficulties with the person who's picking me up at the airport. I'm like, oh, okay. And then... I thought, well, she hasn't told me much, but she's told me a little bit, right? So I have to be delicate. So I said, I can't remember what I said. And she said, I couldn't even begin to say how difficult it is. So she's kind of trying to keep me a little bit, like she doesn't want to let me in. So then I change the subject and I just say, I said, do you live in Dallas? And then she says, yeah, I do. And I said, okay. And then she tells me, she said, I moved here to live with my boyfriend. I said, oh, okay. She said, but I was just visiting my family in Jersey. So I hear that, right? But I don't say anything. And then she said, again, we talked for a little bit more, but she said, yeah, she said, recently I just found some things on his phone that I wish I didn't see. And she said to me, she said, I realize we're just not on the same page. Okay, so what do you address there, right? There's just a lot here, and we're making our descent to the airport. So I just said to her, I said, do you believe? Right? I point her to the Lord. Don't address the moral stuff, because he can do that. I just point her to the Lord. I said, do you believe? And she says, I do. And I said, have you prayed about it? She says, I said, maybe that's a good start. I said, just to pray about it. Ask God. He can help you. You know? And then I looked at her and I said, what's the chances of you sitting next to a priest on your flight? She goes, I know. And then she was a Latina, Hispanic young woman. And I said, my name is Father Emmanuel. I said, my name in Spanish means Dios con nosotros. God is with us. I said, he's with you. Right? So it's a language of mercy. She knows she's in a mess. She just needs to hear, is someone for me? Is someone with me in a way that I can do? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So that's a great question. And I think that's why we have to pray every day, right? We have to ask wisdom and Holy Spirit, give us right judgment, prudence, all these gifts. Okay, any other questions? Okay, awesome. So how about then we can just pray for a little bit, and we're just going to ask just the Holy Spirit just to fill us.